A tumor cell, rapidly growing in a variety of different tissues, it takes up the space and nutrients the healthy organ would need. The end result? Death. In fact, with 10 million deaths worldwide, cancer is the second most common death cause, and with every cancer being unique, they are very difficult to treat. However, this is topic for another video. Today I will talk about a characteristic all cancers share. A characteristic that enables them to grow and multiply so rapidly. The Warburg effect. To understand this, we first need to dig a little deeper into the metabolism of a healthy cell. More specifically, the energy-producing processes. All cells, whether cancer cells, bacteria, or the cute little sperm cell that made you, require energy, whether it's for movement, cell proliferation, molecule transport, or something else. And this energy, it comes in the form of this little molecule, adenosine triphosphate, or better known as the universal energy currency of life, ATP. Cells can generate ATP via two different mechanisms. Substrate-level phosphorylation, in glycolysis or the Krebs cycle, and via oxidative phosphorylation. The ATP yield from glycolysis and oxidative phosphorylation are thereby very different. Take a molecule of glucose, for example, which reacts in glycolysis to form pyruvate, which can then be used in the Krebs cycle and oxidative phosphorylation. The energy yield via substrate-level phosphorylation and glycolysis, two ATP molecules. The energy yield via oxidative phosphorylation, however, 32 to 34 molecules. Therefore, it shouldn't come as a surprise that in most healthy cells, the main pathway for energy production is oxidative phosphorylation. What might come as a surprise, however, is that this is not the case in cancer cells. We'll see. Glycolysis cannot only be used as an upstream pathway for the Krebs cycle and oxidative phosphorylation, but can also be used to produce lactic acid in a process called anaerobic respiration, hence can occur without oxygen. On the side note, if you ever wondered why your muscles hurt during exercise, it is this reaction's fault. During exercise, muscle cells can experience hypoxia and oxygen deficiency, leading to energy production solely happening through glycolysis, which then leads to an accumulation of lactic acid, which in turn you will recognize as soreness. Anyways, back to the topic. In cancer cells, even in the presence of oxygen, the cell will undergo cellular changes that induce this process. They undergo so-called aerobic glycolysis, or the Warburg effect. Essentially, cells stop ATP production via oxidative phosphorylation and substitute it with an increased rate of glycolysis and glucose uptake. Hold on, didn't I just say that oxidative phosphorylation yields much more energy than glycolysis? And shouldn't the rapidly growing cancer cell need even more energy than the normal cell? Well, yes, you are absolutely right, and the question why cancer cells do this is still not completely solved. One of the ideas is that the lactic acid produced benefits the cancer cell. When secreted from cells, lactic acid can damage adjacent cells, including cytotoxic T cells and natural killer immune cells, which would otherwise kill the cancer cell. Therefore, aerobic glycolysis prevents the killing of the cancer by the immune system. Another idea is that the increased uptake of glucose and the formation of glucose-6-phosphate via glycolysis provides substrates for the pentose phosphate pathway, generating NADPH, a key player in overcoming the oxidative stress experienced by cancer cells, and are used for fatty acid and sterol synthesis. Also, cancer cells grow more rapidly than the blood vessels that nourish them. Hence, as the tumor grows, oxygen supply to the cancer cell reduces. The result? Hypoxia. Well, one answer why cancer cells switch to aerobic glycolysis could therefore simply be that cancer cells prepare themselves for this hypoxic event. Finally, the switch to aerobic glycolysis could enable the cancer cell to use the substrates from glycolysis in the Krebs cycle to produce other molecules, hence for biosynthesis. For example, fructose-6-phosphate could be converted into N-acetylglucosamine, a substrate for the modification of many cellular proteins. Dehydroxyacetone phosphate could be used for phospholipid biosynthesis, hence to synthesize new cell membrane to enable cell growth. And 3-phosphoglycerate could be converted into the amino acids glycine and serine, as well as coenzymes required for nucleotide synthesis. All important molecules for cell growth and proliferation. So well, so good. But how do cancer cells do it? How do they switch to aerobic glycolysis? To understand this, let's first have a closer look onto glycolysis, a very complex pathway. However, for now, let's just focus on these molecules. Hexokinase, its product glucose-6-phosphate, and pyruvate kinase. Cancer cells express a special isozyme of hexokinase. This isozymic form binds to mitochondria, enabling the enzyme to not only have ready access to the little amount of ATP produced by oxidative phosphorylation, enabling increased rate of glycolysis, but also to prevent the enzyme from being inhibited by its product, the glucose-6-phosphate. The rate of glycolysis can increase. For pyruvate kinase in cancer cells, its embryonic isozyme is expressed. With a lower catalytic rate than the original pyruvate kinase, the enzyme creates a bottleneck for glycolysis, allowing the accumulation of glycolytic intermediates, probably for biosynthesis purposes. However, it is not just changes in glycolysis itself that contribute to the Warburg effect. We also must consider the bigger picture. As I said before, in healthy tissue, energy production via glycolysis, so-called anaerobic respiration, occurs in tissues with low oxygen levels, hence hypoxia. It might therefore come as no surprise that the transcription factor involved in the cellular changes to increase the rate of glycolysis is the hypoxia-inducible factor 1, or HIF1. HIF1 thereby results in an increased production of glycolytic enzymes, increases the rate of glycolysis, but also increases the uptake of glucose into cells, ensuring sufficient ATP production using only glycolysis. HIF1 thereby also increases the expression of signaling molecules such as the vascular endothelial growth factor that facilitates the growth of blood vessels, providing an increased nutrient supply for the cancer. In healthy cells with sufficient oxygen, HIF1 is hydroxylated by prolyl hydroxylase 2 and subsequently destroyed by the proteasome. Hence, the degradation of HIF1 prevents a change to glycolysis for the main energy production. This prolyl hydroxylase 2 thereby requires alpha-ketoglutarate from the Krebs cycle, vitamin C and oxygen for its activity. Hence, a decrease in oxygen levels due to hypoxia prevents the degradation of HIF1, inducing an increase in the rate of glycolysis. In cancer cells, however, where succinate dehydrogenase or fumarate of the Krebs cycle are defective, succinate and fumarate accumulate in the mitochondria, causing them to spill into the cytoplasm, where they act as competitive inhibitors of the prolyl hydroxylase 2, preventing the degradation of HIF1, hence also increasing the rate of glycolysis. Another enzyme of the Krebs cycle that is important in cancer cells is the isocitrate dehydrogenase, a mutant form of which results in the production of the oncogenic metabolite 2-hydroxyglutarate instead of alpha-ketoglutarate. The 2-hydroxyglutarate can then alter the methylation patterns in DNA, thereby reducing the dependence of growth factors for cell proliferation, promoting unrestrained cell growth and division. Well, there's one more problem now, one mechanism which we haven't considered yet, oxidative phosphorylation. Typically in a healthy cell, the electron transport chain will use the high-energy electrons from the Krebs cycle to pump protons into the intermembrane space of the mitochondria, which can then be used to generate ATP via the ATP synthase. However, if not enough protons are in the intermembrane space, for example because the Krebs cycle is not sufficiently working, such as in cancer cells, ATP synthase can actually work in reverse, hydrolyzing ATP to generate a proton gradient in the intermembrane space. For cancer cells, this would mean that all the beautiful ATP produced by glycolysis is just hydrolyzed for useless mechanisms. To change this, cancer cells can overexpress inhibitory factor 1, which inactivates the function of the ATP synthase, therefore preventing the reverse function in ATP hydrolysis, enabling sufficient ATP production through aerobic glycolysis, or the Warburg effect. Okay, that was a lot, so let me summarize everything for you. Cancer cells mainly generate ATP through aerobic glycolysis, also called the Warburg effect. And while the function of such is not completely known yet, it is probably a combination of acidifying the environment of the cell via lactic acid production, for example to fight off immune cells, to prepare the fast-growing cancer cell for hypoxia, a lack of oxygen, and to increase the number of substrates for biosynthesis pathways. Important to notice hereby that this video is by far not an extensive list of all the mechanisms that induce aerobic glycolysis, but rather an introduction of a topic that I sincerely enjoy, and I hope you enjoy too.